This world can be cold and bitter. Feels like we're in the dead of winter, waiting on something better. But am I really gonna hide forever? Over and over again, I hear your voice in my head. Let your light shine, let your light shine for all to see. Start a fire in my soul, fan the flame and make it grow. So there's no doubt or denying, let it burn so brightly that everyone a little faith, let it start right here in this city, so these old walls will never be the same. Over and over again, I hear your voice in my head. They need to know, I need to go. Spirit, won't you fall on my heart now? Start a fire in my soul, fan the flame and make it grow. So
I'm The things of earth are dimming in the light of your glory and grace. I'll set the sights upon heaven. I'm fixing my eyes on you.
Sorry about that. Shabbat shalom, everybody. I'm going to open with a psalm. Psalm 110, if you'd all rise. Yahweh says to my sovereign, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. Yahweh will send forth the rod of your strength out of Zion, rule in the midst of your enemies. Your people offer themselves willingly in the day of your power in holy array. Out of the womb of the morning, you have the dew of your youth. Yahweh has sworn and will not repent. You are a priest forever, after the order of Melchizedek. Yahweh at your right hand will strike through the kings in the day of his wrath. He will judge among the nations. He will fill the places with dead bodies. He will strike through the head in many countries. He will drink of the brook in the way, therefore will he lift up the head. Father Yahweh, we thank you for the Sabbath day, and we thank you for all the blessings that you've given us. We pray that you'll watch over us throughout the rest of this day, and that you'll bless all those who are observing your Sabbath day. And we thank you for this air-conditioned building and to shield us from the warmth outside, and we pray that you'll watch over all those who are in the heat, and pray that you'll keep them cool and watch over them, especially on the Sabbath day. And we thank you for everything you've given us, especially your son Yahshua, and it's in his name that we pray. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All right, now to the songs. And because my dad is gone, I will be singing. So get ready. Okay back there?
Yeah.
I told her not to stand on a desk chair. She's not supposed to. Alright, up first we're singing I Need You. John, keep the lights. It would ask we have some volume.
Now I come cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Father, you're my hope.
I believe next we're singing Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. I made this list like 20 minutes ago. I should know this. Yes.
Sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. Yahshua, my Savior, has ransomed me. Soon dissolve like snow. the sun forbear to shine. But Yahweh called me here below will be forever mine. Will be forever mine. You are forever mine.
And the final song for this morning will be Please Send the Rain.
Here we are, Father, the sheep of your pasture. Here we are, servants awaiting your word. Children of his soul, dependent on you. Help us and see us.
This morning's speaker, which is Brother John Illgen.
Thank you, Brother Luke. Before we sit down, let's have a word of prayer before we start. Almighty Father Yahweh, we come before you, Father, asking you for you to be here with us now as we deliver this message that you've prepared for us today. We ask, Father, that all of these words are your words, not mine, and that your Holy Spirit is going to direct and guide us today. as we go through this study. We praise you and we worship you, Father, and thank you in the name of your Son, our Savior and King, Yahshua Messiah. Hallelujah. If you'd please be seated. Well, first of all, before I start, I just would like to say thanks very much for the opportunity to worship with you here in Ohio. We bring with us, Melody and I bring with us the greetings of the brethren in Wisconsin. We're from Green Bay, Wisconsin, and we just want to pass on the greetings from the brethren there. They send their love, and we're so really grateful to be here, and grateful to be among Yahweh's people. It's kind of tough sometimes when you're traveling that you don't always find that, and sometimes we plan our trips so we can get near Yahweh's people on Sabbath. So that's a pretty important thing. So I'm going to start with a psalm. We typically start with a psalm, and the psalms are awesome to be able to help us with so many words of wisdom, and you can find virtually anything in the psalms to support any kind of message that you're going to give. So I'm going to start with Psalm 71, and it's a relatively short psalm, so I'm going to say, it reads, "In you, O Yahweh, I have taken refuge. Let me never be ashamed. In your righteousness, deliver and rescue me. Incline your ear to me and save me. Be to me a rock to dwell in, to go to continually. You have given the command to save me, for you are my rock and my stronghold. Rescue me, O my Elohim, out of the hand of the wrong, out of the hand of the unrighteous and cruel, for you are my expectation. Master Yahweh, my trust from my youth, upon you I have leaned from my birth. You took me out of my mother's womb. My praise is continually of you. I have become as a wonder to many, but you are my strong refuge. My mouth is filled with your praise, your splendor all the day. Do not cast me off in the time of old age. When my strength fails, do not forsake me. For my enemies have spoken against me, and those who watch for my life have taken counsel together, saying, Elohim has forsaken him. Pursue and take him, for there is no one to deliver. O Elohim, do not be far from me. My Elohim, hasten to my help. Let those who are adversaries of my life be ashamed, consumed. Let those who seek my evil be covered with reproach and confusion. But I continually wait, and I shall praise you more and more. My mouth recounts your righteousness and your deliverance all the day. Though I do not know their numbers, I come in the might of the Master Yahweh. I make mention of your righteousness, yours alone. Elohim, you have taught me from my youth, and to this day I declare your wonders. And also, when I am old and gray, O Elohim, do not forsake me until I declare your strength to a generation, your might to all those who are to come. For your righteousness, O Elohim, is very high. You who have done great deeds, O Elohim, who is like you? You have shown me great and evil distresses. Revive me again and bring me up again from the depths of the earth. You increase my greatness and comfort me on every side. And with the lyre I praise you for your trustworthiness, O my Elohim. I sing to you with the lyre, O set apart one of Israel. My lips shout for joy when I sing to you. Even my being, which you have redeemed, my tongue too, utters your righteousness all day long. For those who have been seeking my evil, have you been put to shame? You have become abashed." Hallelujah. I can see this podium was built for Solomon, you know, and here I feel like I should be standing on a box or something, but... No, hopefully this will be okay, and really it's probably better this way that you hear and not see. So if you don't mind here, just start a... So today I'm going to talk about freedom, and ask the question, freedom, do you have it? Are you sure? So this week, here in the United States, we observed a national holiday. We observed a national holiday known as Independence Day. It's a day that has been set aside to commemorate the beginning of our nation and also to commemorate the source of our freedom. So here in America, we have several national holidays that, you know, celebrate the freedom that we as Americans enjoy. Among those are Memorial Day. We observed that 6 weeks ago or so at the end of May, and recognizing the men and women who have been killed in armed conflicts on behalf of our nation. And we have Veterans Day that's going to be observed in November, that's observed at the anniversary of the armistice that ended one of the worst wars in human history up to that point, which was World War I. So here in America, it's fashionable to exalt the men and women of the armed forces as heroes who defend our freedom and who sacrifice their lives to protect our freedom. As someone who has previously served in the armed forces, many times I've heard people say, thank you for your service, thank you for your service. The current culture, though, of the adulation of the military hasn't always been the case. If you're old enough to remember, you probably remember during the days of the military draft and the war in Vietnam, even into the late 80s, it wasn't cool to serve in the military or really express any appreciation for military service. In the first Gulf War, that sort of changed. We had a military victory that came about, you know, in a relatively short war in 1991, and the nation, had a military victory in a campaign against an enemy, and the troops came home. And if you remember this, there was parades in Washington, and it was speeches were made, and you know, we had a great victory, and that was it was once again cool, to the populace, and they were to again exalt the men and women of the military. So now we have heroes, you know, who gave us our freedom, and then of course we had 9/11 and all of that, battles and things that we had. And we have, you know, this saying we hear all the time, the land of the free because of the brave. But is that really what happens? So kind of ask yourself this question. After we probably had something in the neighborhood of just shy of 3 million men and women who have been killed since the first shots were fired in the war for independence from Britain. So are you more or less free than you were from where even 30 years ago? We can think about that. What does it really mean to be free? And what or who is the source of your freedom? We're going to go back a little bit in history and kind of talk about some things that happened over our history and how we defined as a culture what the source of our freedom was. In the 17th century, when our ancestors first began to settle this nation, there was one of the founding documents was the New Haven, Connecticut Compact. And that was agreed to on June 4th, 1639, quite a ways back. And so this group of people, relatively small group of people in New Haven, Connecticut, as they were settling this colony, agreed to a set of principles. And one of those were that everyone voted on these things. So they asked for everyone's consent. And one of those, the first one actually, read, whether the scriptures do hold a perfect rule for the direction and government of all men in all duties which they are to perform to Yahweh, they use of course common titles, and men, as well as families and commonwealth, as in matters of the church or the assembly. It was assented to by all, no man dissenting, And as it was expressed by holding up of hands, afterwards it was read over to them that they might see in what words their votes were expressed. And they, again, expressed their consent by holding up their hands, no man dissenting. So one of the first founding documents boldly put out there that the source of our laws, the source of our governance, the source of authority was the Holy Bible, the scriptures. So as time went by, we're going to fast forward about 140 years or so. So the Constitution of the colony of Delaware, and we have a somewhat weaker stance than we did in New Haven, Connecticut 140 years ago. But in part of their constitution, they required the men who served there to affirm the following, that they do profess faith in Yahweh the Father and in Yahshua his only son. Again, I'm substituting for the common titles. And the Holy Spirit as one God, one G-O-D, blessed forevermore. And I do acknowledge the holy scriptures of the Old and New Testament to be given by divine inspiration. So this was, again, a public document that used the holy scriptures as sort of their basis, a little weaker than it was before. But now we come to the Declaration of Independence, where we cite all of the reasons why we're separating ourselves from the nation we were a part of, which was Great Britain, and in the Declaration of Independence, when we're declaring to the king, King George III, why we're doing this, why we're separating ourselves. Part of that says we are endowed by our Creator. So again, we get a little weaker. We're just calling him sort of a Creator. With certain inalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. So 11 years later, when the U.S. Constitution was ratified, basically the document that we're under now, was ratified by the founders, they kind of took another step and declared that we, the people, are the source of our authority, not Yahweh, not the Bible, not scriptures, but we the people have replaced divine inspiration and the words of Yahweh as the authority to govern ourselves. So we're the ones who has ordained and established the laws by which we govern ourselves. And fast forward to where we are right now. So now laws are made and rights are conferred by basically 9 men in black robes. We have the judiciary, the court system, ultimately the Supreme Court, and these men can make or restrict our freedom based on their own personal ideas and values. I mean, we're seeing this right now. We've got a vacancy that's happened on the court, and the whole country is blowing up about it. And why is that? Is because these men, these 9 individuals that sit on that court, really determine what laws are going to be enforced and what are not. They can create law out of whole cloth like they have in the past. And I'll give you an example. One is Proposition 8 in California. Some of you might remember that in 2008, the state of California passed Proposition 8 by a pretty significant margin. And the people said that by a referendum that marriage should be between one man and one woman. So the Supreme Court said, no, I don't think so. We're not going to do that. We're going to strike down that law, and we're at where we're at right now. So to put it in today's language, sort of how is that working out for you? We can see here a progression of the source of authority for our governance. We can first, the scriptures were the authority, then men who agreed that the scriptures were inspired, then a general agreement that the source of our rights were endowed by a creator, then the authority became we the people, or the ultimate consent of the government, and now the authority is a very few people in the judiciary. So again, how is that working out for us? What's the desire of our Creator, Almighty Father Yahweh, for us? What does it really mean to be free? So we have this concept of Americans of freedom, and really, is that Yahweh's concept of freedom? Is that really what we should be thinking about? So let's kind of dig into this a little bit and really see what the scriptures talk about freedom. What does it mean to be free? Does it mean we're able to do anything we want without consequence? Does freedom mean that we're free to make our own laws? Are we free to blaspheme and worship idols? Well, the First Amendment would give us that right. We can do that. There's no legal consequence for, you know, saying anything against the Almighty. Are we free to engage in intimate relationships with anyone we choose? Again, there's no legal consequences for that now. There were in times past, but there isn't now. The Supreme Court has upheld laws to that effect, and really, if you think about it, we're free to engage in all kinds of behavior that, for example, adultery, idolatry, hatred, fits of wrath, selfish ambition, envy, drunkenness. You probably recognize that list. You know, it comes from Galatians 5, verse 19. There's a whole list of works of the flesh that really are legal in America here. We have the theoretical right, of course, to engage in this kind of behavior. But, you know, what does Galatians 5:19 tell us as believers? Gives us this long list of works of the flesh. And in verse 20, we see that will keep us from the kingdom of Yahweh. It will keep us out of the kingdom if we engage in these kinds of behaviors. There's a long list of behaviors we as American citizens are free to do without punishment by the government. And is this really what these men and women fought for and died for? Is that really what they had in mind in the war for independence from Great Britain, or, you know, any of the wars that we've fought? Is that what these men and women had in mind when they went off to battle? Any of us who are parents know that allowing a child to make up their own rules is not a good thing for that child. That's why we make some rules for them. We hold them close. We help them to understand right and wrong. So we as parents know that inevitably, if we allow our children to make up their own rules, it's going to bring about a lot of pain and ultimately their destruction. Fortunately, we do have a loving Father. We do have a Father that has given us some rules and has given us some ways to behave and a path to walk on that we can avoid that destruction. So I'd like to talk to you about the one who actually does have the power to make us free, and that's Yahshua the Messiah. So Yahshua was speaking with some of the religious elite of his days, and the discourse between them is recorded by the Apostle John, Yohanan. And they were talking about freedom. So let's turn to this account in John chapter 8. And this is, you know, a pretty extensive teaching that Yahshua was given here, but we're going to pick this up in verse 31. And so Yahshua says to those Jews, or Yudahim, who believed in him, "If you stay in my word, you are truly my disciples," or my taught ones. "And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." And they, that is the Pharisees, and answered him and said, "We are the seed of Abraham and have been servants to no one at any time. How do you say we shall become free?" And Yahshua answered them and gave him the key, the really the essence of what he was really all about. And he said, "Truly, truly, I say to you, everyone doing sin is a servant to sin. And the servant does not stay in the house forever. A son stays forever. If then the son makes you free, then you shall be free indeed." So we sang a song here earlier about my chains are gone. I've been set free. And really, this is what Yahshua is talking about. He was talking about redeeming us. He didn't set us free to give us the ability or the permission to act in any way we wanted to and act in any way that was harmful to ourselves. He gave us a way to live and gave us the redemption that we could be redeemed from our prior actions, what we did before we understood Yahweh's way of life. So these Pharisees that Yahshua was talking to, this religious elite, they completely misunderstood what Yahshua was talking about. It went right over their head. They just didn't get this at all. They were relating on a completely physical level, stating that they were not subject to any human government or institution. They said, quoting them here, it says, "We are the seed of Abraham and been servants to no one." Which is kind of an odd thing to say if you think about it, because they were under Roman occupation, you know. So what were they thinking, really, is kind of what I would say there. Yahshua, though, on the other hand, was trying to help them understand a spiritual point and was relating to them on a spiritual level, something these scribes and Pharisees just didn't understand at all. They just did not get that. Similarly, do we have the same misunderstanding about freedom? Are we looking at the concept of freedom on a physical level rather than a spiritual level as these same Pharisees did? So let's go to the Apostle Kepha, Peter, in his first letter, 1 Peter 2, and in verse 13. So Kepha gives us another witness of this. He basically reiterates Yahshua's teaching when he wrote in his first letter. I'm reading here from the scriptures version here. And in verse 13, he says, "Be subject to every institution of man because of the master, whether to the sovereign as supreme or to governors, as to those who are sent by him for the punishment of evildoers, and a praise for those who do good." But we read here in verse 15, "Because such is the desire of Elohim, that by doing good, you put to silence the ignorance of foolish men, as free," and here's the key again, "yet not using your freedom as a cloak for evil, but as servants of Elohim." So Peter and Yahshua are talking about freedom in a completely different level than most people of the world really have any idea of. Our teacher Shaul in Galatians chapter 5 gives us another witness to that. In Galatians, in Paul's letter to the Galatians, he says in chapter 5 and beginning in verse 13, he says, "For you, brothers, have been called to freedom. Only do not use freedom as an occasion for the flesh, but through love serve one another." So this is completely different than anything we've really heard before, anything the world really teaches as what freedom is really all about. So Melody and I were, this week, actually it was 2 days ago, on Thursday, we went to see the Creation Museum and the Ark in Kentucky. So that was really the point of how we ended up in Ohio, is we wanted to see that. And this, there was a short film there that really illustrates this point that when I saw that, it just kind of shocked me a little bit. So just imagine they've got an interview. If some of you have been there, you know you've seen this, but they've got a film, and it's basically a reporter going to talk to Noah, and they're putting this reporter sort of in a modern context. You know, they're giving them the sort of attributes that we would see a CNN reporter or MSNBC or some, you know, sort of, you know, leftish progressive reporter would act, and how they would behave if they were really interviewing Noah. And this woman reporter, you know, was dressed in her modern fashions and stuff, and she brought along two production assistants. One was a scribe, and one was a would have been a videographer. He was actually making a sketch. So the scribe, as this reporter is talking to Noah, she's kind of, you know, doing her sort of CNN type of interview type of thing, you know, looking down her nose at Noah and, you know, treating him, talking to him like he was a moron and an idiot, and, how could you be so stupid to believe the Creator told you these things, to build this ark? And Noah replies to her, you know, this is happening because Yahweh, or, you know, of course they use the common titles, Yahweh is sending this flood as a judgment upon the earth for sin, the sin and violence. And this scribe, who's a big hulky guy, you know, he's like 7 feet tall, full of tattoos and all this stuff, and he stands up and he gets really angry, and he says, what you call sin, I call freedom. And that kind of shook me, and I said, you know, that's right. That's what it's really what the world does. And that's where we get this idea of freedom, is really freedom to disobey the Creator and freedom to destroy ourselves. And that's really where we've kind of got ourselves into. But our Father Yahweh has always, from the beginning, has given us freedom. He's always given us a choice. So at the very beginning, if we'd even turn back to Genesis in chapter 4, and the very first time the very first time would have been the choice between that Adam and Hava, Eve, had when Yahweh gave them a choice. He said, you know, I'm setting before you a tree of life, and I'm setting before you a tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And you can eat from one, I don't want you to eat from the other one. And of course they didn't, you know, so they had a choice. They began with a choice. And again, their first son Cain, before he murdered his brother, Yahweh kind of pleaded with him and tried to help him through a difficult time. He was angry, he was frustrated, he was upset. And why was he like that? It's because he didn't follow the rules. He didn't follow what Yahweh gave him. You know, for he chose the freedom to do what I wanted to. I didn't want to give an animal sacrifice. I wanted to give my vegetables or my crops. And he was angry because he goes, you know, this isn't fair. I want to do my thing. And what did Yahweh say to him? He said, is it not if you do good, you are to be accepted? And if you do not do good, towards you the door is sin, or the sin is crouching at the door in some translations. Render this. And he's lying, and his desire, and he sort of uses a literary device here in personifying sin, is said it is crouching at the door, and it's lying towards you, and its desire is for you. It wants to devour you, and you must rule over it. You know, Cain decided to use the freedom that Yahweh gave him to make a different choice. you know, to go another way, and ended up killing his brother, and his a whole line of descendants after him became, you know, wicked and evil, and followed evil ways, and became literally the sons of men as opposed to the sons of Elohim. So Yahweh has always pointed out, but as Yahshua pointed out to the Pharisees earlier, how you choose is going to decide whether you're a slave or free. Whether we're a slave to sin, you know, that's what Yahshua taught us, that if we choose that way, we really put ourselves in bondage. And as the song told us, you know, when we follow Yahweh's ways, our chains are gone. We're not captive. We're not in bondage. We're not slaves to sin. But we're free. And where are we free from? We're free, really, from the penalty that sin brings. We're free from the consequence of sin, because Yahshua wants to pay that penalty for us. We deserve it. You know, of course, all of us have sinned. All of us have fallen short of the glory of Elohim. But without Yahshua paying that penalty for us, we would be slaves to sin and really have to pay that death penalty ourselves. Hallelujah, we don't have that. Yahshua loved us so much that he gave his own life so that we could be free from that. So in Deuteronomy, just as the nation of Israel, after they have been set free from the sin, the bondage that they were in, sort of a type of sin in Egypt, Yahweh brought them out of that horrible condition, that terrible slavery, that hard bondage, brought them out and was about to bring them into the promised land, into a land that was flowing with milk and honey, and a land abundant and wonderful. In chapter 30 and in verse 15, we're going to start in verse 15, but again, Yahweh, as he's communicating to the nation of Israel through Moshe, has said, again, talking about freedom, says, "See, I have set before you life and good, and death and evil, in that I am commanding you today to love Yahweh, your Elohim, to walk in his ways and to guard his commands and his laws and his right rulings. And you shall live and increase, and Yahweh, your Elohim, shall bless you in the land which you go to possess. But if your heart turns away, and you do not obey, and you shall be drawn away, and shall bow down to other mighty ones and serve them, I have declared to you today that you shall certainly perish. You shall not prolong your days in the land which you are passing over the Jordan to possess. I have called the heavens and the earth as witnesses today against you, and have set before you life and death, blessing and the curse. And therefore, you shall choose life, so that you live, both you and your seed, and to love Yahweh, your Elohim, to obey his voice, cling to him, for he is your life and the length of your days, to dwell in the land which Yahweh swore to your fathers, to Abraham, to Yitzhak, to Jacob, to give them." So again, we have Yahweh putting choices before us, giving us freedom. He did not create us as robots. He did not create us as, you know, just mind-numbed, doing whatever we're programmed to do. He did give us a choice. And his desire for us is to have voluntary compliance. He wants us to choose him and to walk in his ways because we love him, because we know that he knows better than we do. He's created this entire universe. And as we know, with being parents of children, we know better than a small child does. And we love them so much, we give them direction and we help them with through their life and help them make the right decisions. And that's what our Father Yahweh has given to us. So what do we think about freedom? Have the world's ideas or Western culture infiltrated our freedom? excuse me. How about us? We have constitutional rights, don't we? We have freedom of speech. The First Amendment gives us a right really to say anything we want, right? But does that match with the scriptures? Does that really match with what the way that Yahweh has laid out for us to walk? We see in the half-brother of Yahshua, the apostle Jacob, James, says in chapter 1, verse 26, says, if anyone among you thinks he is religious and does not bridle his tongue, he deceives his own heart. This one's religion is worthless. And then in chapter 3, verses 5 through 8, again, he talks a little bit about what we say, and it really doesn't match the First Amendment at all. So James says, so too the tongue is a little member, yet boasts greatly. See how a little fire kindles a great forest? And the tongue is a fire, the world of unrighteousness. Among our members, the tongue is set, but the one defiling the entire body and setting on fire the wheel of life. It is set on fire by Gehenna. For every kind of wild beast and bird, of reptile and creature of the sea is tamed and has been tamed by mankind, but no one is able to tame the tongue. It is unruly, evil, and filled with deadly poison. So, you know, we can come up with lots of examples about, you know, where the Constitution or the Supreme Court has given us rights that are in contrast with the scriptures. And of course, we have a choice. And we've chosen a way of life that Yahweh has set before us, called the narrow path. It's called the way. It's called that way that Yahweh has set before us, the way to life. And we've freely chosen that. We've been called and given that understanding. And isn't that a wonderful thing? So I want to touch on one more aspect of freedom, and that's if we go to Romans, Shaul's letter to the Romans, and in chapter 8, I'd like to kind of talk about this one point. So in Romans chapter 8, and we're going to begin in verse 1, and he says, there is then no condemnation to those who are in Messiah Yahshua, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For the Torah of the Spirit of the life in Messiah Yahshua has set me free from the Torah of sin and death. So this is some of our friends who follow Christianity will tell you, see, the law is done away with. We're free from that. We don't have to follow these rules. Now we can do anything we want, and whatever we do, we're forgiven, because Yahshua has already paid the price for anything we do in the future. Isn't that what this says? So we're free from the penalty of sin and death. So, and they use this story that Shaul recounts in Galatians chapter 4, and it's sort of an allegory, and it very clearly actually says it's an allegory. Beginning in verse 21, we're talking about the difference between the two covenants, between the Old Covenant and the New Covenant. And one is represented by Hagar, the bondwoman, and Sarah, the free woman, you know? And so I'm not going to go read through the entire passage here, but all of us are pretty familiar with this. But I'm going to just bring out a couple of verses here. So He says in verse 22, "For it's been written that Abraham had two sons, one by a female servant, one by a free woman. But he who was of the female servant was born according to the flesh, and he of the free woman through the promise." And he very clearly says this is allegorical. Okay? "For these are the two covenants, one indeed from Mount Sinai, one bring forth slavery, which is Hagar. For Hagar is Mount Sinai in Arabia and corresponds to Jerusalem, which now is, and is in slavery with her children. But the Jerusalem above is free." So, you know, some of our Christian friends will point this out and say, see, the law is slavery and the promise is freedom. But Shaul really is sort of a little bit covered up in here, but he very clearly says what he's talking about, though, by enslaving is those who, and this is in chapter 5, verse 4, he says, "You who are declared right by Torah," or "you who assume that you're justified by the law, because you keep the law, because you follow these 613 commands, that you're justified, that you're right before Yahweh." And we know that that's not true. The Torah never was able to save anybody. Nowhere in the New Testament or in the Old Testament does it say if you follow these rules, you automatically are guaranteed salvation. It's not. In fact, we have the example of Israel who walked through the desert for 40 years, and only two men were able to go into the promised land. So the Torah can't save us, but it does teach us the way to walk, and it does teach us the way to freedom. It does give us the way that we're to go to be able to walk into the promised land. So he kind of accumulates there in verse 13. It says, "For you brothers have been called to freedom, not only to use freedom as an occasion for the flesh, but to through love serve one another. The entire Torah is completed in one word, in this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself." So going back to Romans again, we're still in Romans. We're going to back up to Romans chapter 6. And really, Paul talks again a little bit more about how the law doesn't save us, but it's so important to our walk. The Torah is given to us to understand this way that we're to walk on. So let's go to Romans chapter 6, and beginning in verse 15. So the beginning of chapter 6, he's talking, you know, about the law, and he says, "For sin shall," in verse 14, "For sin shall not rule over you, for you are not under the law, but under grace." And then he answers a question that, you know, inevitably pops up. The rhetorical question is, what then? Shall we sin because we are not under Torah, but under favor or grace? Paul very clearly says, let it not be. Of course not. "Do you not know that to whom you present your servants for obedience, you are servants of the one whom you obey, whether sin to death or of obedience to righteousness?" So again, this is the same thing that Yahshua was talking about. Who you obey, that's what determines really to whom you are a servant to. And we want to be servants of Yahweh. We want to be servants of the Most High. We want to be servants, obedient servants who are following Yahweh's ways and following his way of life. Not because he forces us to, not because we have to, but because we love Yahweh and we want to be part of his very family. We want to be part of his family and live with him forever. We don't follow the law. We don't follow Torah because of anything Yahweh forces us to do. Again, he wants voluntary cooperation, voluntary compliance. So continuing on here, he says, and having been set free from sin, you became servants of righteousness. I speak as a man because of the weakness of your flesh. For even as you did present your members as servants of uncleanness and of lawlessness, resulting in lawlessness, so now present your members as servants of righteousness, resulting in holiness or set apartness. For when you were servants of sin, you were free from righteousness. Is that really what we want to be free from? From righteousness? Of course not. We want to be slaves of righteousness. We want to be servants of Yahweh. And continuing on, therefore, in verse 21 in chapter 6, he says, what fruit, therefore, were you, having then over which you are now ashamed? For the end thereof is death. And that's a natural consequence of a life of sin, really. That's what the world will reap if they're not able to come to the point of repentance. And fortunately for them, that Yahweh has given them a way to do that, and everyone in their own time. But now, having been set free from sin and having become servants of Elohim, you have your fruit resulting in set apartness and the end, everlasting life. For the wages of sin is death, but the favorable gift of Elohim is everlasting life in Messiah Yahshua, our master. So what a beautiful thing that is, that we have this instruction coming from Yahweh, inspired words that we can follow. A couple more things about freedom here that we receive in following Yahweh's way of life, and that is in 2 Corinthians 3, verse 17. It says, and now Yahweh is a spirit, and where the spirit of Yahweh is, there is freedom. And again, in the writings of Yaakov, in chapter 1, verses 23 to 25, he says, if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he's like a man who looks at his natural face in a mirror. For he looks at himself and he goes away and immediately forgets what he was like. But he that looked into the perfect Torah, that of freedom, continues in it, not becoming a hearer that forgets, but a doer of work. This one shall be blessed in his doing. Again, more freedom, the perfect law of freedom. And that's the Torah. Because what does that do? By following Yahweh's way of life, following his instructions, following the foundation that he gave us in the Torah, we do have freedom. We do have, eventually, we'll have life eternal with Yahweh, our Creator. So when we fall into the world's definition of freedom, or even the Christian church's definition of freedom, we become as Peter or Kepha described, and he's describing false teachers and false prophets, people that lead us astray, people that try to steal our freedom from us. In 2 Peter chapter 2, and in verse 18, he says, for speaking arrogant nonsense, they, these false prophets and teachers, through lust of the flesh, through indecencies, the ones who have indeed escaped from those living in delusion, promising them freedom, though they themselves being slaves of corruption. For one is a slave to whatever overcomes him. For if after they have escaped the defilements of the world through the knowledge of the Master and Savior, Yahshua Messiah, they are again entangled in them and overcome, the latter end is worse than the first. And this is sort of a warning to us as believers and following this way, that not to fall for these false teachers that sound good, that sound like, you know, we don't have to do the things that we do. You know, we don't have to keep the Sabbath. Don't worry, that's all done away with. Or, you know, it's just like any other day. Or, you know, we can don't have to go to the feast. You don't have to keep tabernacles. It's expensive and it's hard, and you have to take off of work and all of that stuff, all those things that we hear from people in the world. Don't fall for that, because that's a lie, and that will take us off the course. It'll take us off of this narrow path that we're on right now. So as I wrap this up, I just want to kind of point about, we here in America, we are enormously blessed. Of all the places in the world where Yahweh could have had us born, he had us born in the most abundant land that exists on the earth right now. In a tremendous abundance, and we're relatively free from persecution, unlike believers in lots of other places in the world. I mean, there are people that are literally being killed for their beliefs right now in 2018, and we don't face that. We do face some scorn and ridicule sometimes. We do face some, you know, job persecution or things like that. We'll have, you know, people that will fire us because we keep the Sabbath, things like that. But it's, in the scheme of things, that's relatively minor. You know, we do live in an abundant land that we should be very, very grateful for, to Yahweh for his tremendous blessing. But what we don't want to do, while we don't want to fall into the world's idea of freedom and disregard our Father's way of life, we also don't want to appear to the world and be stumbling blocks to them by appearing to be disrespectful to, you know, the traditions and the culture that we find ourselves in. We don't want to behave in a disrespectful manner. As you know, as Paul points out in Hebrews, in chapter 11, he calls us, different translations will say this a little differently, but mine says it'll calls us aliens and strangers on the earth. So we back up in chapter 11, back up to verse 9. By belief, this is talking about Abraham, sojourned in a land of promise as a stranger, dwelling in tents with Yitzhak and Jacob, as heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking to the city, having foundations whose builder and maker is Elohim. So we're doing the same thing that Abraham did. We're looking forward to that new Jerusalem. We're looking forward to the millennium, to the time when Yeshua will return to this earth and return it to the paradise that Yahweh and created it in and wanted it to be, and what his intention originally was. And so belief also, Sarah herself was enabled to conceive seed, and she bore a child when she was past the normal age, because she deemed him trustworthy who had promised. So, and in chapter, or verse 13 anyway, in belief, all of these died. This whole chapter of delineating all these people of faith. But seeing them from a distance, welcome and embrace them and confess that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth, or aliens and strangers on the earth. And that's really what we are. We're sojourning in this earth. You know, we happen to be born in America, but we could have been born anywhere. We're born here. And we don't want to use the unrighteous activities of our government, and certainly there are many. There's no doubt about that. Some people will disagree on what those are, but depending on your political point of view. But we don't want to be in a position where we're rebelling against authority and refusing, for example, well, you'll hear of some people that want to refuse to pay taxes. You know, and we look in Romans 13, and it's very clear, pay your taxes, you know. Or they don't want to stand up for the flag because, they, you know, it's whatever reason. Well, that's sort of disrespectful. You know, Romans 13 very clearly says to give honor to whom honor is due, respect to whom respect is due. Not an act of worship by standing up and being respectful for and really grateful for the ability to live here. I mean, it's a wonderful privilege and a wonderful benefit that Yahweh has provided to us, that some people say, well, you know, I don't want the state involved, and I can, you know, I'm not going to get legally married because I don't have to do that. Well, again, that's sort of walking in a disobedient manner. It's walking in a way that brings disrespect upon the people of Yahweh, because the world looks at us like, well, when you do things like that, they say like, well, you're lawbreakers. And I don't really want to hear anything you have to say because of the way you behave. You can probably heard many times that, you know, I can't hear what you're saying because of, you know, the sermon you're preaching by the way you walk. We don't want to be like that. Father Yahweh doesn't look favorably upon rebellion, and he doesn't look favorably upon disrespect. And in fact, in 1 Samuel 15:23, you know, he talks about, he was admonishing King Saul, the first king of Israel. He says, rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, you know, and some people might say, well, you know, what harm was that? He didn't respect Yahweh's laws. He didn't respect Yahweh's instruction. And he was rebellious. We don't want to be like that. Again, Romans 13 gives us quite clear instructions on how our behavior should be in society. Yahweh places people in authority in the government, and he places them, sometimes those people don't behave very well. And of course, no one is advocating that we would do obey a civil law and break one of Yahweh's laws. Of course not. But virtually none of the laws that the government puts upon us, yeah, sometimes they're onerous, sometimes they might not seem fair, sometimes they don't follow their own rules, but they don't contradict the Torah. Now, for example, if the government said, well, you're gonna have to work every day, every Saturday, well, we'd say, sorry, we're not doing that. You know, we're do like Peter said, we'll obey Yahweh rather than men. But where it doesn't conflict, you know, we should be obedient citizens. We should be people who are good examples to the around us. We want to be light and salt. We want to be people that the world is attracted to because of the way we live. We want to be different. We want to be a peculiar people. We don't want to be people who are looked upon by society as evildoers. You know, we just don't want to be like that. So we're to be lights to the world. And as I wrap this up, I just want to say, praise Yahweh that has given us deliverance from the eternal consequences of sin and death. So that's really where our freedom comes from. And I'm going to just go back to the opening psalm that I started with as I conclude this. And in Psalm chapter 71, in verses 2 and 3, the reason I picked this was, it says, in your righteousness deliver and rescue me. Incline your ear to me and save me. Be to me a rock to dwell in. To go to continually, you have given the command to save me, for you are my rock and my stronghold. What a tremendous comfort that is, that Yahweh, Yahshua, is our rock. That we have this solid foundation. We know what's going to happen in the future. We know what's ahead of us. We know this tremendous blessing that waits ahead of us, and we're so grateful for that. And as Martin Luther King said, he said, free at last, free at last. Thank Yahweh Almighty, we are free at last. And that's really true. He didn't really understand what he was talking about, but those words really ring true for us. So we are free. We are free from the consequence of sin and death. We are free to be able to walk in this way, to walk in Yahweh's ways. And we're so very thankful for that. Hope this message has been a blessing to you. Hallelujah.
Well, good morning, everyone. This is Solomon. I don't know if you can hear me or not. I wasn't sure if I was going to get introduced. I was just going to get my line unmuted. So if you get a chance, Luke, send me a text and tell me you can hear me. So I am on the other end of the country. I wasn't able to make it back this week for services, which I am realizing as I was watching services this morning on the video stream as you were getting started, how much I miss having services at Enduring Hope. It's been a full month, I think, since I was there, just because of travel for work and also travel over to Pennsylvania to just appreciate the blessing that Yahweh gave us in the miracle of safe delivery of our grandson and Melissa and Paul's first child. That's really been a delight for us. And something that's just been more than words can express. Going up to complete strangers and showing them cute pictures of little Benaiah. And I don't mind that at all. Brother John, I really do appreciate your words this morning. Thank you for the offer to back up and bring a teaching this morning. And I really was blessed with everything you said and so many of the points that you made. And I was marveling at how Yahweh's Spirit works, because as I am listening to you, I realized how much what you were saying was dovetailing into what Yahweh had laid on my heart to share with everyone this morning. I saw something that was a little troubling this past week. It was a video of a kind of on-the-street survey that was done by a political reporter, and they went from person to person that were at a 4th of July celebration or activity in a community. I believe it was in Southern California. And person after person after person was asked to answer just really simple questions about what Independence Day meant and what was the history of the day and even who are we independent from or what are we independent from. And person after person failed to have an answer that made any sense. They really didn't know why we celebrate the 4th of July, why Independence Day is significant. And I was watching it, and it was, you know, it's humorous on a very low level, but then it's also very troubling. And I thought a lot about the parable of the 10 virgins and how what we're seeing in our society today is really indicative of a period where people are sleeping. Over in Matthew chapter 25 is where we find that parable, and it doesn't apply directly to what I'm describing, but I think it's a form of what we're seeing out there. I'll just start at the head of the chapter. Joshua says this. He says, "The kingdom of heaven is likened to 10 virgins who took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. And 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. For the foolish, when they took their lamps, took no oil with them, but the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. Now while the bridegroom stayed, they all slumbered and slept. But at midnight there is a cry, 'Behold, the bridegroom, come forth to meet him.' Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said to the wise, 'Give us your oil, for our lamps are going out.' But the wise answered, saying, 'Perhaps there will not be enough for us and you. Go rather to them that sell and buy for yourselves.' And while they went away to buy, the bridegroom came, and they that were ready went in with him to the marriage feast, and the door was shut. Afterward also came the other virgin, saying, 'Master, Master, open to us.' But he answered and said, 'Truly I say to you, I know you not. Watch, therefore, for you know not the day nor the hour.'" I think we live in a time where it's not 50-50. It's not 5 wise and 5 foolish. I think we're really kind of at 5% that are awake and aware, and 95% that are sleeping in our nation, and by extension, I think, in the world. Maybe I'm being cynical. Maybe the number's a little better than that, but it's not good. Most people are content to be unaware of what is happening, where we're going, what we're anticipating, what we expect to see transpire in the end days. Most don't even want to acknowledge that we're in the end days. But to take that concern and bring it back into the body of the Messiah, we have to ask ourselves, how many of us have prepared for the return of the bridegroom? How many of us are asleep, slumbering in this period and not prepared? We don't have the oil. We don't have the word of Yahweh. We don't have the blessing of Yahweh, the favor of Yahweh, all the things that oil represents in Scripture. We don't have that prepared, and therefore we're not ready to meet the bridegroom. It's troubling, and it's something that I think we all should make sure that we are taking the time to consider as we go through each day and week by week and month by month and year by year as we anticipate the return of our Savior. It was the point that really came home to me in seeing that video that was circulating was, how can we be people who are free? How can we understand what freedom means if we don't understand what it is that we are free from? I think the colonists 245 years ago understood what tyranny was. I looked it up. I wanted to know specifically, what does the term tyranny mean? It is cruel. It is unreasonable. It is an arbitrary use of power or control. King George of England exerted that sort of cruel, unreasonable, arbitrary power over the Americans. In fact, they were not alone in that. The colonies around the world were under the heavy authority of the sovereign nations of Europe. And the Americans stood up and they said, we will cast off that restraint. We will no longer bow to the weight of tyranny. But where do we find tyranny in our world today? Where do we see unreasonable authority? Because I think for those who are asleep, we're still under tyranny. We have allowed the creeping tyranny of an oppressive government, as Brother John described. We've traded a sovereign Yahweh for a small group of authoritarians in our government that control so much, whether it's from the executive branch, from the judiciary, from the legislative branch. There's a small number of those who control and wield the power in our government, and they oppress the people of this nation in so many ways. But this isn't meant to be a political statement. It's really meant for us to keep this in the spiritual understanding. In Matthew chapter 20, Yahshua the Messiah was talking to the disciples, and the controversy had broken out between the sons of Zebedee over which one would be greater in authority, which one would have more power in the kingdom, which one would be able to rule more people, perhaps. And it says in verse 24, it says that when the 10 heard it, when the other 10 of Yahshua's apostles heard these two having this controversy and arguing over which one was going to be more powerful, it says that they were moved with indignation concerning these two brothers. Yahshua calls them to him. He sees there's this controversy brewing within the 12, so he brings them all together. And he says this to them. He says, you know that the rulers of the Gentiles domineer over them. In some translations, it says they lord their authority. They act as though they are Elohim. They act as though they have power beyond what they have been given. He says the rulers of the Gentiles domineer over them, over the people, so that their great ones exercise authority over them. He says, not so shall it be among you. But whoever would become great among you, let him be your servant. And whoever would be first among you, let him be your bondman. John, Brother John used the expression, and I loved it. Be a bondservant to righteousness. Be a bondservant to your freedom. Yahweh's given us a choice. Make yourself a slave to that. Make yourself a slave to each other, to your brother. But beyond that, make yourself a bondservant. Make yourself a slave to everyone you encounter, every person with whom you interact. Find some way to serve them. Find some way to help them. It can be as simple as a smile. It can be a helping hand. It can be a kind word. We hope and we pray for those instances where the help that we can give someone is a witness that draws them closer to Yahweh, in word or in deed. But find ways to be a servant, not to seek authority, not to embrace tyranny or to seek some sort of domineering control over other people, but find ways to serve in every instance. He says, even as the Son of Man came not to be served unto, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. We spoke last week about giving your life for someone else. Not necessarily losing your life, but giving your life. Surrender yourself to help someone else. Sacrifice yourself. And I think we see clearly here that that's what Yahshua is describing as the good news that we should have. It is a message of freedom. It is a message of choice. And that message is propagated by those who embrace that freedom and understand it, who are righteous and obedient and observant of the law, and yet are able to demonstrate love in an all-encompassing, overflowing way. I think in our context, we fall trapped to these devices that the power brokers thrust upon the people. They create false controversy, false choices. As Brother Illgen mentioned, the furor that's raging in this country right now over the selection of one of these Supreme Court justices. And yet, while we're arguing right or left, right or wrong, up or down, front or back, what we're ignoring is the true struggle. The thing that really is the tyranny of this world. And that tyranny is sin. A sin that comes from us opening the door and embracing the work of the flesh to slide down to the lowest denominator of our existence and just cave in to our human and fleshly cravings. Brother John mentioned it's completely legal to do most of those things in most areas. You're not going to run afoul of the government if you engage in all of these sins, but you will run afoul of the judgment of Almighty Yahweh. It's not acceptable. It's not allowable for us to just disregard Yahweh's law and disregard his direction and then just give in to the worst form of who we can be in every instance. To continue where Brother John left off in Galatians 5 and verse 16, Paul writes this. He says, walk by the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusts against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh, for these are contrary the one to the other, that you may not do the things that you would. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. That's not saying that we are not subject to the laws of Yahweh. The law that Paul is describing there is the law of punishment, the destruction. If we allow the Spirit to motivate us and lead us and guide us and direct us and drive us, then we're not going to receive the punishments and curses that Yahweh has laid out, but that we can embrace the opportunity that he has made for us to walk in that freedom in reality, it's important for us to keep those things in context, keep a proper perspective upon them. Paul clearly was someone who struggled with the battle between flesh and spirit. He spoke of this over in Romans chapter 7. Maybe we'll go over there and take a look. I didn't mean to give a whole speaking here, but I'm sort of led to keep talking about this. In Romans 7, Paul says this in verse 15. He says, "For that which I do, I know not. For not what I would, that do I practice. But what I hate, that I do. But if what I would not, that I do, I consent to the law that is good." Now, Paul has a confusing way of presenting some things, especially when we bring them from him speaking in the Hebrew or Semitic tongue through Greek into English. It kind of gets twisted up. I think clearly when he was speaking it originally, it probably was much easier to understand. But we can see what he's saying here. What he's telling us is that if we just do the things that come naturally, we're going to destroy ourselves. But if we take on a new nature, if we become a welcome host to the Holy Spirit of Almighty Yahweh, if we allow the fruit of that Spirit to manifest in our bodies and in our minds and our actions and our words and in our thoughts, then the things that we do naturally will naturally be of the Spirit. And the things that we would do normally in that circumstance are not the things that will destroy us. So the choice that we have is to become a welcome host of the Spirit, to be cleansed in water baptism, to accept Yahshua the Messiah as our Savior and Redeemer, to seek the ways of Yahweh, to nurture the Spirit by engaging the Spirit, both through the reading of the Word and through interaction with that Spirit in others who have the Holy Spirit demonstrated and manifested in their life. You see, when Adam and Eve made the choice, and they had a choice, as John just said, they had a choice, and when they made the choice to sin, to partake of the tree, when Yahweh had told them not to, they set this tyranny of sin, this curse of sin, upon all mankind. And it wasn't that single action that did it. It was the way that we were created. And the reason we've been created in this manner is because we have to be overcomers. We have to be Israelites. We have to be ones who rule their lives well with the power of Elohim. We have to understand that if we do not draw close to Yahweh, if we do not seek His ways, then we are vessels that have been created for sin. But that's not what Yahweh wants. He wants us to be obedient children. He wants us to be redeemed. He wants us to be saved. He wants us to be overcomers. So we break the curse of Adam. We make the right choice. And in doing that, we are following the example of Yahshua the Messiah, which is just truly amazing how Paul expresses this in 1 Corinthians 15. In verse 21, he says, "For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead." It was through one of the descendants of Adam and Eve, through the descendants of the ones who made the decision to sin and therefore manifested our human inclination to sin, that through one of the descendants of that sin, there was one who made the choice correctly. There was one who overcame in all circumstances. There was one who was able to beat back temptation. And there was one who honored his Father in all things, was perfect and righteous and without sin. And that one was Yahshua the Messiah. For since sin came through man, by man also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in the Messiah shall all be made alive. In the Messiah, we shall all be made alive. If we can choose to not sin, if we can overcome in every instance, if we can overcome temptation, and yet that's so difficult, it's impossible. Everything we see in Scripture shows us that it is impossible for us to be perfected in ourselves. And this is why Paul writes, in Messiah shall all be made alive. Because where we come up short, the blood of Yahshua brings us to perfection. But only if we acknowledge our own weakness, and only if we acknowledge that our strength is in him. Then just as he was made alive in resurrection, because that's where our true freedom is going to come. Our true freedom is going to be when we shed our physical bodies and are elevated and brought into the spiritual perfection of a body that is not made for sin, but a body that is there to glorify Almighty Yahweh, our Creator. Yahshua showed us the path. He did the will of Yahweh. He gave his life for Almighty Yahweh, and then Yahweh resurrected that body. And now, if we can follow that pathway, and we know that we can, and we know the promise is there, we know ultimately that when we are resurrected, it will be in a new form. Paul goes on to describe that in great detail in 1 Corinthians 15. It's one of the most inspiring passages of Scripture. He says, in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, we shall be made new. It's inspiring to read that. But in Revelation 21, John described this vision for us. He says, I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were gone, and the sea is no more. A new creation. And maybe it will be only in that moment that we will all truly and fully comprehend how this earth and everything about this earth was temporary. It was created for a purpose. And once that purpose is fulfilled, it'll be washed away. It'll be burned up. And Yahweh will have a new heaven, a new earth, a new creation. A holy city, the new Jerusalem. Made ready as a bride adorned for her husband. And then the presence of the tabernacle of Yahweh, where we will reach that ultimate union with the one who made us in fulfillment of his purpose. Our presence will dwell with his for eternity. The tabernacle of Yahweh is with men, and he shall tabernacle with them, and they shall be his peoples, and Yahweh himself shall be with them and be their Elohim, and he shall wipe away every tear from their eyes. And death shall be no more. The tyranny of sin, this disgusting, filthy sin that's attached to our mortal bodies, will be dead because the mortal body will be gone. Death will be no more. Tears will be no more. No mourning, no crying, nor pain anymore. The first things are passed away. What was the first thing? Adam and Eve, in the flesh, choosing not Yahweh's way, but the way of man. They chose to fulfill their fleshly lust, and the flesh lusts against the spirit. The first things will be passed away. Friends, that should encourage us to meet each day with a renewed determination to choose wisely. Yahweh has given us the freedom of choice. He's laid out two paths for us. One path leads to destruction and the other to eternal life. There's no middle ground. There's only two roads. We can choose the right path. Each and every day, we can choose Yahweh's way, and we can choose life. So praise Yahweh for that message that he's given us and that plan of salvation. And if you would, just join me in a word of prayer, and I'll conclude here. Father Yahweh, we're just so humbled when we consider our poor estate, when we realize and recognize the situation that we have been placed within, and we have so much to overcome. And yet, we find freedom in knowing that we have a choice, and we find blessing in knowing that that choice draws us closer to you. So, Father, just help us in each and every day, in each and every moment, to honor you, to seek you, to draw closer to you. We just thank you for the work that you're doing in our lives and in our hearts, in our minds, to cleanse us, to wash us of the filth and limitation of a mortal, sinful existence, and preparing us for an eternal spiritual blessing in your presence. Father, we just want to thank you for that inspiration, for that thought, that determination that you raise up within each one of us to seek you, to draw closer to you, and to walk in your ways. Father, we want to honor you by being obedient children. So we thank you for this Sabbath day. It's a sign between us and you, and we just thank you, Father, for the way that you have given us a weekly reminder that you are our Creator, you are our Father, and that you desire a relationship with us. And the Sabbath is that sign. So we just praise you, Father, for the opportunity to gather together, whether it's in person or whether it's through electronic means or even just through the Spirit, Father. Just continue to draw us together as your people. Help us to recognize one another, to strengthen one another, to lift each other up so that we can press on in this journey. Give us continuing hope in our heart, for we know that the day of Yahweh is coming. And we're not fearful, Father, but we are excited and anticipating it in a way, Father, that only you understand, because we know that you anticipate it as well, because you want your people, your children, to be close with you as any father would. We love you, Father. We thank you for the one that you sent as our Redeemer and our example, Yahshua the Messiah. Father, we thank you for Yahshua's determination, his strong will, and his humility, his love and his compassion, his service, and his patience. And as our high priest, Father, we just thank you so much for the way that Yahshua serves there with you in the throne room as our intermediary. And Yahshua, as we present this prayer, we ask that you present it to our Father. We just want to thank you and express our love to you as well. And it's through you, as our high priest, and in your name, that we present this prayer and say, Amen and Hallelujah. Well, friends, I am glad for the opportunity to be able to speak with all of you, and I want to say hello to my family. I miss you guys. It was good to hear you singing. And I hope you have a great Sabbath, and I look forward to being home soon. Yahweh bless.
We're going to close with a song. Blessed be the name, I hope.
Blessed be your name, and that is plentiful, streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. found in the desert place, a walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, you still I stay.
Elohim, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary, and the young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in Yahweh will renew their strength. He will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. Hallelujah. Well, have a good Sabbath, everybody, and I look forward to speaking to you next weekend. Shabbat Shalom.
8 o'clock tonight for prayer list.
8 o'clock tonight for closing benediction, closing the Sabbath, and I'll talk to you then.
This is an ad for project management. Called Monday.com. This is what it looks like.
Trust, we overcome. Take every chain that kept us slaves and throw them off. We're not waiting for permission. We defy our inhibition. Like our middle name is fearless, unafraid. If we're gonna we'll be right back.
has been before.